Hello everyone, and welcome to the St. Louis Art Museum's Art Speaks program. My name is Jessica Kennedy, and I'm the educator for adult learning at the museum. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end of each speaker's talk. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. For today's student research showcase, we are joined by three graduate students from Washington University in St. Louis. For further introduction, I will now pass the mic to their professor, Elizabeth Childs, the Etta and Mark Steinberg Professor of Art History and the Chair of the Department of Art History and Archaeology at Washington University. Thanks so much, Liz.
Good morning. Good morning. Jessica, thank you so much. We are really honored to offer the inaugural session of Art Speaks Student Research Showcase. I want to mention that these presentations came out of a seminar taught here at WashU by myself last spring on exoticism and primitivism in modern European art, which is a course that covered the 19th and early 20th centuries and instances of artistic encounter and interpretation and travel from Europe to non-European cultures and consideration of non-European identities. Students gave their talks in the galleries last spring, which was a wonderful experience in front of the works of art. And it's our hope that these presentations will stimulate you all to come into the museum to see these paintings. The three featured paintings are on view. I'll start with very brief introductions of each of the three graduate students and then invite them to go ahead and give their presentations. Our first presentation will be by Hoyon Mephokee, who is a second year PhD student. His major area of study is 19th century French art, and he's very interested in studying the cultural connections between France and its colonial contacts in Southeast Asia. His research continues the work he started as an undergraduate at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and then as a master's student at American University in DC, where he examined how the histories of colonialism and empire are manifest in public sculptures and spaces. He's publishing work from his master's thesis in a co-authored chapter in a volume on sculptural representation and personifications of the continents and their peoples. His talk today links to his broader interest in examining visual and material culture as reflections and agents of colonial attitudes. I am going to give all three introductions now, so our transition between the talks will be relatively quick. Our second talk will be offered by Elizabeth Mangone, who did her BA at Furman University in Greenville, South Carolina, and majored in studio art and economics. She is now a second year MA student in our program at WashU, and she's generally interested in the modern period in Europe with specific interests in the development of abstraction within Western art. Her gallery talk links to her broader research on the painting you'll be hearing about, which she published an article about entitled Bloody Vestiges Out of the Night, Racialization and Adolphe Yvon's Genius of America. This came out in Boston University's journal Sequitur just this past June, as well as her continuing research on the artist Adolphe Yvon. So we congratulate her for getting an article out so quickly on this research. And then our third presentation will be by Katie DiDomenico, who is a second year PhD student in the program, focusing on early modern Netherlandish visual arts and material culture. Her interests include the circulation of objects in trade networks, cross-cultural interaction, collecting practices, materiality, and issues of identity and representation. She received BA degrees in art history and Spanish at the University of Akron in 2009, which she followed with an MA in Spanish from the University of Akron in 2011. She then taught Spanish language, literature, and culture at the College of Worcester for 7 years, and in 2019, returned to graduate school and got an MA in art history from Case Western University. Prior to starting the program at WashU last year, she held intern and research positions at the National Gallery of Art in DC, the Cleveland Museum of Art, and the Akron Art Museum. So these are three extremely ambitious and accomplished graduate students. I'm so pleased they can share their research with you. Let's turn first to Hoyon.
Thank you so much for those introductions, Dr. Childs, and good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for joining us today. My presentation will be on Frank Dillon's 1856, The Colossal Pair, Thebes. This is a fascinating painting that I will use to explore two interrelated representational modes, Orientalism and Romanticism. Today, I hope to suggest to you the ways in which the tenets of Orientalism were deployed by the Romanticists, and to show that for artists like Dillon, the Orient served as a set of ready-made and easily accessible sites and signifiers with which to explore, contemplate, and negotiate their ideas and concerns. And these terms, if these terms are unfamiliar to you, I will address them as they come, so fear not. For now, let us begin with the object at hand. The Colossal Pair, Thebes is an oil painting that depicts a pair of large stone monuments in a desolate and marsh-like setting. Aside from the skeletal remains of what appears to have once been a camel and a lone structure in a deep background, the landscape is largely devoid of life. The vast emptiness of the landscape, the deep horizontality of the work, and a camel all contribute to the aura of death and decay that permeates the work. In this magnification, we can see how this sense of desolation is also heightened by the exaggerated size and scale of the monuments. These quite literally monumental objects are even further emphasized by the low vantage point and the low horizon line from which we access the scene. Through Dillon's perspective, we are quite literally looking up at these monuments. The sun sets in the west behind them as the evening star shines between them and is reflected in the waters beneath. I've pointed out the evening star and the camel skeleton for convenience. Holding together the work is the original frame that includes six orbs with wings, intertwining snake-like shapes, and acanthus leaf ornaments. In addition to the striking gold color and ornamentation, the frame is also notable for its unexpected and unusual arch-like feature that includes more foliage ornaments and alters the shape of the canvas. Thus, the work presents a landscape that is mysterious, sensuous, evocative, powerful, and dare I say, even romantic in some ways, thus making it a work of British Romanticism par excellence. So how do we know that this work depicts the setting sun? Is it merely conjecture that what we are seeing is the evening star in the sky? Although this may appear to us as a generic scene of ancient Egyptian ruins, contemporaneous viewers seeing this exhibited at the British Institution in 1867 would have been able to locate the site both geographically and temporally. The title, The Colossal Pair, Thebes, gives us clues. Indeed, Dillon's painting depicts the Colossi of Memnon, a pair of stone monuments of the pharaoh Amenhotep III. They stand in front of the ruins of a temple in the Theban necropolis, where pharaohs were buried and face east towards Nile. The waters in the painting are an accurate feature of the site, as the monuments stood on the edge of the Nile floodplain. Publications from the 19th century reveal that this was a well-known site, as Egyptomania gripped Europe in the wake of Napoleon I's 1798 to 1801 campaigns in Egypt and Syria. Even five decades after Napoleon's campaigns, the site remained a fixture in a popular consciousness and in the itineraries of travelers. Dillon himself visited Egypt from 1854 to 1855 and produced this work upon his return to England from memory and with the aid of sketches and other images that he produced on his travels. However, it is clear that he made some deliberate aesthetic choices when representing the site. Here I turn to Edward Said's Orientalism, a key text that describes the phenomenon of Orientalism, a way of studying the region loosely defined as the Orient, or what we might today call the Middle East and North Africa, as well as a representational system that depicted this region, its people, cultures, sites, and spaces as inherently oppositional to those of the Occident or Western Europe. Key to this is the fact that Orientalism is not merely a process of transmission from real to visual or real to literary, but one of transformation, during which ideology and politics became infused into these representations. As Said writes, the Orient was Orientalized not because it was discovered to be Oriental in all of those ways considered commonplace by an average 19th century European, but also because it could be made Oriental. Essentially, there's a gap between these real sites, spaces, peoples, objects, and norms, and their depictions in European culture. And when Dillon took the Colossi of Memnon and turned it, or transformed it, into the subject of a painting, he injected his own subjectivity into it. For Dillon, this included his political moment and his identity as a citizen of the British Empire, as well as the broader culture milieu in which he operated. So what does it mean then for a romanticist like Dillon to infuse this well-known site with his political ideas and concerns? For those unfamiliar with the term, romanticism refers to a musical, literary, artistic, and intellectual movement that originated in Europe and was prominent between 1880 and the 1850s, that emphasized subjectivity, imagination, emotion, spirit, and that disavowed science, industrialization, and modernity in favor of nature and a relationship to the cosmos. Some of you may recognize Caspar David Friedrich's Monk by the Sea, which is certainly among the best-known exemplars of Romanticism. Despite it being a work by a German artist, it shares much with Dillon's haunting landscape, if only superficially. So what I want to focus on specifically in Dillon's work is the ruinous quality of the site, this emphasis on the monuments via lighting, composition, scale, and atmospheric and astronomical elements that are deeply related to what scholars have described as a quote-unquote poetics of decline in British Romanticism, wherein sites of ruin are used to explore ideas of British decline in imperial power, in masculine identity, and in colonial supremacy. So this cult of ruins is evident also in the fact that the work was exhibited with a few lines from the Percy Shelley poem, Ozymandias. Nothing beside remains, round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare. The lone and level sands stretch far away. Although it's not clear how the poem was part of the work's original exhibition, it's very likely that it appeared on some printed material, a wall text perhaps. What is curious is that this emphasis on ruin and decay as a result of neglect and civilizational decline is another aspect of Orientalist painting that scholars have described. European paintings of the Orient, as scholar Linda Nochlin says, is characterized by the persistence of monuments, architecture, and infrastructure in disrepair. For many in Europe, where industrialization and modernization had taken hold, the Orient was a place absent of industrious productivity, and this quote-unquote absence of work signaled both a more primitive state of civilization than that of Europe, and Europe's civilizational superiority over those in the Orient. And now it may seem misaligned that Romanticism would use the Orient to contemplate the decline of the British Empire when the disrepair of the Orient seems so often to serve to communicate that the empire was in good shape. Here it is good to remember Romanticism's emphasis on the natural and spiritual and its disavowal of the industrial and scientific. This characterization of Europe as being productive and industrious was therefore not necessarily a good thing in the eyes of the Romanticists. The combination of Oriental and Romanticist aesthetics in Dillon's work therefore presents Egypt not as a foil for Europe, but as a potential future for the British Empire in a state of disrepair that can come about as a result of rampant industrialization and poor resource management. Curiously, if the image itself presents Egypt in a negative light, it is as a cautionary tale for the British Empire's potential decline. Its frame seems to present the mysticism and spirituality of Egypt embodied in the popular consciousness as a positive. Although it is difficult to determine how interested Dillon was in the metaphysical, the frame certainly evokes these themes so strongly in their materiality and iconography. Relatedly, the shape of the frame also frames the image into something resembling religious architecture. There is certainly an evocation of the spiritual here in a way that complicates this aforementioned idea of Europe as being a potential future for the British Empire. While the question of intent presents a challenge for art historians, the fact that Dillon did not paint into the areas of his canvas that the frame covers shows that he clearly painted the work with this frame in mind. Here you will see what the canvas looks like beneath this frame. The stark materiality of the frame also adds a confounding dimension to the role of the Orient in British Romanticism. If spirituality and mysticism present potential solutions to or ways of escaping from industrialization, what does it say about Dillon's work that Egypt presents a site for potential decline and potential recovery? But considering the image and frame, I would argue that Orientalism and the Orient appear as ambivalence in Romanticism. Indeed, if the composition presented the Orient as presenting a potentially catastrophic future, the frame simultaneously suggests that the mysticism and spirituality long associated with the East are possible remedies against the ravages of modern life. It is clear that, as a consequence of Romanticism's various investments, the Orient came to signal a number of meanings, many of which directly contradicted one another. While I showed how Dillon's work expresses this ambivalence of the Oriental, it also suggests how Orientalism operates at, and continues to operate as a highly malleable set of ideas and visual techniques whose meanings and modes of deployment were context dependent. Of course, for Dillon, the tenets of Orientalism took a form as a response to the conditions of the British Empire as a global military, economic, and colonial enterprise. Thank you.
Hoyon, thank you so much for starting us off. That was fascinating. And your slides of the frame are so excellent. I just encourage everyone to get to the St. Louis Art Museum because the frame is every bit as interesting as the painting. And you've interpreted that so well for us. I'll offer just a quick question to start us off. I encourage the audience to be typing in their questions into the Q&A, not the chat, the Q&A. And then Hoyon will carry on reading from those. But just a quick question. I find sometimes the term Orientalism can be surprising to viewers or readers who think it should include the Far East. And certainly, as you've explained it, it really engages the political realm of colonialism and imperialism in the British sphere. Can you address kind of the geographic parameters, again, of what Orientalism includes and doesn't include from the point of view of late 19th century Britain?
Right. So with Western Europe, it seems that the term encompassed much of what we might describe as the Middle East or North Africa. So Egypt, Syria, Turkey, even. Although scholars have noted how with American artists, the term the Orient sort of came to represent what we might call the Far East, Japan and China, for instance. So yes, for the 19th century in Britain, the Orient is a very specifically North African and quote-unquote Middle Eastern region, and of course all the politics and colonial activities that are directly related to that.
Thanks. I think that's helpful. Why don't I turn it to you to see if you have anything in the chat and in the Q&A, and if not, I've got another one.
It seems like there are no questions in the Q&A box currently.
Then let me give you the next one. You made the point early on that looking at these, at the colossal pair, it seems like we're looking up at them, and it absolutely seems to be the case. And also we're sort of looking at the skeletal remains of the camel. And then you relate it to this wonderful context of religious architecture. And it made me think of something I've never asked you before. Do we know how it was installed in any of its 19th century venues? Was it, you know, kind of at eye height, or was it perhaps elevated in an exhibition? Like maybe it.
Yes. So, right. I believe it was installed at eye height. So as I mentioned, the work was originally exhibited at the British Institution, 1867. So shortly after the work was, not long after the work was completed. And this was a private, a private organization. And from what I understand, the exhibitions were fairly small and limited. So it does seem to make sense that given the venue and given the membership of this organization, it was likely exhibited at eye level. Although that's purely conjecture, there's nothing in the literature that suggests how it was exhibited.
Yeah, and another thing too on the slide is it seems vast, and it's actually a painting that's just the right size for a viewer to be in front of. There's something very deceptive about that desert. It seems it could be 20 feet long. And could you just remind us of its approximate dimensions?
Yes. So here. There. Oh, sorry. I suppose it's not on
just,
the.
You can just estimate.
Yes, it's. I want to say around. It's a couple of feet wide is what I remember. I don't have the exact dimensions in front of me right now.
No, that makes the point. It's just, you know, the.
Yeah, it's very large. Yes, it's. Yeah. Yeah, certainly a very intense viewing experience when you see it up close in person.
I hope everyone can get to see it. And Jessica, do you want to pass this to the next talk now?
Well, sure. Actually, there are a couple questions in the chat. So Hoyon, if you don't mind maybe choosing one to answer, we have a little bit of time to do one of those.
Oh, okay. Let's see.
Or I can read one out if you'd like me to.
I can't. Okay, so Jay Buchanan is a current student, and a very interesting question. He says, so we consider the ornate frame and rounded band of the canvas a means of domesticating, claiming, or fencing in the monumental Orientalist landscape. And he also considers the towering scale of the Colossi. Yes, I so something that I'm was very interested in is this idea of this sort of the beauty of the frame as this shiny, attractive material thing that allows sort of presents the work and its contents as something to be claimed, as something to be materially owned and possessed. So no, that is not much of a reach. It's something I've certainly considered, and of course that is complicated by this idea of Egypt, or it sort of ties into this idea of Egypt as being this complicated site that is both a site of desire and a site of something to be sort of to not desire, I suppose, for lack of a better word.
All right, thank you. And actually, off the top of your head, do you know what gallery this is in? If not, I can look it up. But someone has asked where the museum can
Yes,
find this piece.
actually this is this this piece is actually right next to the work that Katie will be presenting in. So I'm sure she will be mentioning that in during her presentation. I'm afraid I
Great.
don't have the exact number up from the top of my head right now.
Not a problem. We can find it. All right, thank you so much. All right, so
Thank you.
now next up we have Elizabeth.
All right. Hello, everybody, and thank you, Hoyon, for your lovely presentation on that painting. Today, I will be discussing Genius of America, an 1868 painting by the French painter Adolphe Yvon. I'm going to take you through some of the major compositional elements of the video, or sorry, of the painting, give you a little bit of the work's history, and tell you about the people involved in its creation. This painting depicts an allegorical scene of the reconciliation of the North and the South after the end of the American Civil War in 1865. The fact that it's allegorical means that the figures and events shown in the painting are symbolic rather than an image of any real historical incident. This painting was completed about 3 years after the end of the Civil War, and so can help to give insight into the experience and thinking of the contemporaneous time period. At the very center of the composition are two figures standing hand in hand. The woman on the left in white robes represents liberty or the American Republic. She is holding some sort of mathematical or scientific tool which lends an association to reasoning and logic. Her companion in the green robes is wisdom. Her armor, helm, and spear are likely references to the Greek and Roman goddesses of wisdom, Athena and Minerva, especially given that her breastplate has a Medusa-like snake-haired head on it, a symbol commonly associated with those goddesses. Beneath their feet, inscribed onto the chariot they are standing on, are the words "E pluribus unum," meaning "out of many, one." These words, which were the original motto of the United States as established in 1776, must have seemed especially appropriate to include in a painting about the two broken halves of the country reuniting. The left side of the painting primarily deals with immigration and the future of the United States. The people depicted here are identified specifically as European immigrants in Adolphe Yvon's description of the painting. Some of them are already on American soil, while others are waiting to step down off their boat. They are all dressed simply and carry with them agricultural tools such as the shovel over one man's shoulder. The yoked cattle and the covered wagons also suggest an agrarian lifestyle and westward expansion. The eyes of the immigrants are turned towards liberty and wisdom at the center of the painting, with men tipping their caps and women waving their handkerchiefs towards these figures. In the top left, more ships are visible waiting in the harbor. As opposed to the Greco-Roman allegorical figures in the center of the work and the happy immigrants to the left, the right register of the painting is shrouded in darkness. This area of the painting deals mostly with the perceived American past. At the top, there's a statue of George Washington, which is being lauded with laurel crowns as the first president of the United States, and thus the ultimate representation of the country's past and history. Beside the statue, as one of the symbols of the United States, is a bald eagle. The statue is surrounded by an army of angelic figures, which are slaying demons and monsters behind it and rushing past to proclaim the glory of the United States. At the bottom right are Yvon's representations of newly freed Black men and women, as well as Indigenous Americans. They are standing in front of an empty field of war, as evidenced by the gallows lurking behind the figures. In his description of the painting published at the 1870 Salon exhibition in Paris, Yvon said of this scene, quote, "On the right, bloody vestiges represent the past. From this night emerged the populations of color, from the Indians whom the light begins to fall upon, to the Blacks, whom the whites raise, moralize, and free," end quote. Regarding those three stated actions, raising, moralizing, and freeing, we can observe visual indicators for each of them in the painting. The Black man at the front is being raised by the Union soldier behind him, who is identifiable as such by his blue uniform. Behind them, there's a minister teaching the Bible, fulfilling the idea of moralizing. And the woman in the green cloak is freeing the man below her by removing his chains, which can be seen looped around her hand. The figures in this corner of the painting illustrate the reality that while Black people were no longer legally enslaved in the post-Civil War United States, white people of the time still believed in racial stereotypes from both sides of the war. One such stereotype is paternalism, or the idea that Black people were infantile and needed guidance from whites in order to achieve morality or a productive place in society. This belief is exemplified in a contrast between the white immigrants in the left register and the Black people depicted here. The white immigrants are shown bringing tools and agricultural technology with them. They are prepared to build their lives in their new home and contribute to the country's well-being. The newly freed Black people, on the other hand, are depicted without tools or technology, despite the fact that many, if not most, enslaved people in the United States were forced to work in the agricultural sector. They would have been proficient with the technology exhibited in the left register. Instead, however, Yvon has shown them as helpless, needing assistance to even stand or remove the chains from their bodies. One of the other racial stereotypes represented in this painting is the idea of Black people being hyper-emotional. The Black man being raised up by the Union soldier is overcome with emotion, sprawling across the canvas in an attempt to reach out and upward towards the allegorical figures of liberty and wisdom and the light emanating from the left side of the scene. These and other stereotypes were alternatively used as both justifications for and arguments against slavery and later segregation. Similar stereotypes were also used as a justification in the westward expansion across the United States and persecution of Indigenous Americans, as well as colonial ventures by European countries, such as the artist Yvon's native France. Now that we have examined the painting itself, we can turn to the work's history. According to Henry Juan, one of Yvon's contemporaries, the idea for the painting came from Yvon's own interest in the Civil War. Juan said, quote, "The War of Secession had struck Yvon. He had proposed not to recreate a battle, but to execute a large painting containing the allegory of the reconciliation of the North and the South. A rich American, Monsieur Stewart, having seen the sketch, commissioned the picture." That rich American was Alexander Turney Stewart, a Scots-Irish immigrant who became an extremely successful retail businessman after immigrating to the United States at the age of 16 and settling in New York. Several aspects of this painting may reflect Stewart's own personal biography, such as the presence of immigrants representing new hope and a bright future for the United States, and the presence of the minister in the right register, as Stewart himself studied to become an Anglican minister before his immigration. Even the prominent placement of the uniformed Union soldier may reference the fact that Stewart, through his textile business, helped manufacture the Union uniforms during the war. The artist of this painting, Adolphe Yvon, was a French academic painter. His status as an academic painter means that he worked within the French Academy of Fine Arts and followed a largely realistic style of painting. He was born in Eschweiler in 1817 and studied drawing in Le Havre under Monsieur Auchard and painting in Paris with the academic painter Paul Delaroche. His early work dealt primarily with religious subjects, but he became famous for his battle paintings, especially those he produced for the French Second Republic during the Crimean War. So while allegorical paintings are somewhat uncommon in Yvon's body of work, the subject of war is typical to his interests. Yvon actually produced two versions of Genius of America for Stuart. The one which hangs in the St. Louis Art Museum is 35 by 59 inches, whereas the second version, currently on display at the New York State Education Building in Albany, New York, is a mural which measures 29 and a half by 18 feet. It's unknown at this point whether both paintings were part of the original commission or if one was created first and then the other added upon its completion, but both paintings ultimately ended up in Stuart's collection. The mural-sized version, however, was first exhibited at the 1870 Salon exhibition in Paris. Later, it was installed in the ballroom of the Grand Union Hotel in Saratoga Springs, New York, which Stuart owned. Both in Paris and in New York, the painting was met with largely critical reviews. The French critique was typically that the work was too extravagant and fed the American ego. Americans, on the other hand, thought it was fanciful and cliched and were confused by the inclusion of aspects such as the cherubs in the foreground. Ultimately, however, Genius of America is a complicated representation of the post-Civil War period and its European creators' viewpoints on an American war. It also has many details that we were not able to discuss here today. So if you're able to, I encourage you to go visit it at the St. Louis Art Museum and see it for yourself. I'm also happy to answer any questions people have at this time.
Elizabeth, thank you. You took us through a very complicated work in record time. We appreciate that very much. And again, we encourage people to go ahead and pose your questions in the Q&A, and Elizabeth will have a chance to read them and address them. I'll just start off with one. As you took us through it this time, it struck me more than it ever has before how homogeneous and uniform the allegorical figures are in the middle. They might have different gowns, they might have different hair color, but they're the same height, the same build, the same face, the same rosy cheeks, the same red lips. So you have these extremely homogeneous figures who represent the abstract thoughts, as allegories do, liberty, wisdom, etc. And then on the left side, you have this immigrant population that you delineated very well, which has a terrific range of pose, gesture, bearing, and physiognomy. And my question for you is, because it's hard for us on the computers or on the computer screen to really see the variation of the figures at the far right that represent the indigenous and the enslaved or formerly enslaved peoples of America, does Yvon give the same physiognomic variety to those figures, those more minority figures on the right, as he accords to the immigrants? And here, your knowledge of the painting will help those of us who may not have seen it in person, but hopefully encourage us to get back to the St. Louis Art Museum. I know those figures are stereotypical, but physiognomically, does he give them the kind of range of humanity in their bodies and expressions that you find he accords to the immigrants?
That's a great question. I think it's not one that I've thought specifically about before, but I think it's one that's worth thinking about moving forward. I think that there is certainly a range, but the range is more designed to fit into like the stereotype of hyper-emotionality. And so if you look at the expressions and poses that are represented on the right side of the painting, it far more falls into shock and awe and sort of an overwhelmed range of emotions rather than the perhaps calmer and more hopeful rather than awestruck expressions and poses that we're seeing on the left side with the immigrants. And so I definitely think that there is a play there happening with people's opinions of racial stereotypes at the time.
Yeah, I would agree. You've got me looking carefully. And I think there the physiognomic variation falls within codes of bodily expressions inherited from Le Brun and others.
Yes, most certainly. Yeah.
So maybe there's some questions that have shown up in the Q&A, but thank you for guiding us through this very detailed picture.
Yeah. I see one question here from Amy Torbert asking, if I had a magic wand, would I keep this painting installed where it is among 19th century European paintings, or would I propose that we should display it in the historical American galleries? Or if we should mix up such divisions entirely? I think that's such a great question. This is a complicated painting to answer that, because it definitely does fall into European painting, because the commissioner was Scots-Irish and the painter was French, but it deals primarily with American history. I think it would be a really interesting piece to put in the American history area, I think, or in the American galleries, just because it is so heavily influenced by American history. I think with qualifications that it was not actually made by an American painter, I think that would be very interesting to see and might enable a really interesting wall text conversation to happen there. So thank you for that question, Amy. I think that's a great one.
Probably have time for one more question.
Okay, great. Let's see. I see one here from Brendan Hay asking what the foreground cherubs signify. That's a great question. I wasn't able to cover all of the allegorical elements of this painting. As you can see, there's a lot going on. And so I appreciate the chance to say that now. The cherubs are identified by Yvon as the spirits of labor and the arts. So you can see one of them is holding a painter's palette. They have mathematical and engineering tools with them. And so they are meant to represent sort of the industry of America and where that will go after the war.
Great, thank you. And I do just want to, so I did look up the gallery. So this painting is currently in gallery 207. And then the other two, so the one that Hoyon spoke about and the one that Katie is going to speak about are both in gallery 205. So hopefully people can go find them there. And with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Katie.
So good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for joining us today, and to SLAM and Jessica for hosting this event. Today, I'll be speaking about the painting you see on screen, Jean-Léon Gérôme's The Sentinel at the Sultan's Tomb. So what are we looking at here? This is an oil painting about 3 feet high and 2 feet wide, and was painted around 1880 by a French artist named Jean-Léon Gérôme. The painting shows the interior of the tomb of an Ottoman sultan in Turkey. The sarcophagus is this orange object here, topped with flags, and surrounding it are five figures. One figure standing, presumably the sentinel referenced in the title, and four figures in prayer, one standing and three seated. Now, before we dive deeper into the imagery, I'd like to give you a little background on the artist and the historical context in which this was painted. Gérôme was active from around the middle of the 19th century to the beginning of the 20th century. And at this time, European colonial expansion into Africa and the Middle East was really starting to ramp up, and France had a large hand in this. These new colonial contacts intensified what has become known as Orientalism in the arts and literature, and Hoyon spoke about this as well. So a lot of European artists and writers began traveling to parts of North Africa and the Middle East to find inspiration for their work. However, many art historians and cultural critics have noted that the resulting works often presented a romanticized, fictionalized or essentialized view of the Middle East and its people, based more on preconceived notions that reflected colonialist attitudes. And I'm showing here a few examples of Orientalist works in SLAM's collection. This painting in the middle here is actually on display in the same gallery as mine and Hoyon's. which is just adjacent to the gallery that holds Elizabeth's painting. So Jerome was a leading Orientalist painter and has been quoted as once saying, "The Orient was my most frequent dream." In fact, about 2/3 of his total body of work comprises Orientalist paintings based on his travels through Egypt, Turkey, Greece, Palestine, Syria, Sinai, and North Africa. So he was very well traveled for someone of his time. And during these trips, Jerome would make sketches and collect photographs and objects that he brought back with him to his Parisian studio, which we can see here on screen. And it was in the studio in Paris that he composed and executed his paintings of the Orient. And here is where I want to get at one of the primary issues surrounding this work. Many Orientalist painters were praised for the perceived documentary quality of their works. Indeed, at first glance, this painting has a very true-to-life feel. It's highly detailed. There's a lot of attention given to surface, material, and gestures. And it looks almost photographic. Most importantly, Jerome had actually traveled to Turkey. So for his audience at the time, he was an eyewitness to the Middle East. And the assumption was that there was truth in his images. However, the thing about artworks is that they cannot promise to present a 100% reality because they're always filtered through the mind and the hand of the artist. And in this case, the memory of the artist as well, since this work was not painted on site, but in Jerome's studio after the fact. So for me, the big question I had about this painting was, to what extent does this visual representation of the Middle East present a reality or a fiction? And this is a tricky question to answer because I think there's a little bit of both. So let's take a look at some of the visual details in the painting and see if we can try to parse this out. I'd like to first focus on the setting. As I mentioned, it's intended to represent the mausoleum of an Ottoman sultan. When Jerome traveled to Turkey, one of the places he visited was a city called Bursa, which is noted for its Ottoman mosques and mausoleums, including the green tomb of Sultan Mehmed I, which we know for sure Jerome visited. If we were to compare this present-day image of the green tomb on the right with Jerome's painting, though, it's clear that there are some discrepancies. Nevertheless, he likely visited a number of other tombs, as this is a subject that he portrayed at least 5 times throughout his career. In terms of architecture, the setting of Jerome's painting does indeed resemble Ottoman architecture, particularly the blue and white tile interiors found in Ottoman palaces, such as Topkapi Palace in Istanbul. Now, Jerome did have parts of his Parisian studio covered with actual tiles that he had brought back from his travels as a way to sort of set the stage for his paintings. So in this sense, Jerome's work appears to be a fairly accurate representation of the architecture since he was working from actual specimens of tiles. However, this breaks down a bit anywhere we encounter Arabic text in Jerome's work. If we look at these white ceramic cartouches in the alcove, they are covered in pseudo-Arabic script. So it's not accurate. Jerome didn't know Arabic, and it seems he only included this script here to make the scene appear more authentic and perhaps to give it a touch of the exotic, because that's how this culture was perceived by Europeans as distant and exotic. On the other hand, this small tomb marker at the front of the sarcophagus has Jerome's signature very clearly and legibly displayed, reinforcing his authority over the image and his supposed status as an eyewitness. As for the sarcophagus itself, it's difficult to say. The ones I've encountered online do have this very intricate carving that we see in the Jerome painting, but I haven't yet come across one that's the same burnt orange color. Jerome had a liking for this particular orange pigment, and I'm thinking he may have used it more as a compositional choice to balance out the darker tones in the painting, rather than basing it on an actual sarcophagus he had seen. Now, on the other hand, the 10 brightly colored flags at the top do actually represent those used by Ottomans for their flags in terms of the colors, primarily red, green, and gold, which we can see in the examples on the right. But I haven't been able to trace the designs to a historical source. So in this case, it seems that Jerome, working from memory of his travels, accurately recalled the colors of the flags, but not necessarily the details of their designs. Next, I thought we'd take a look at the figures in the painting. They are all with their backs to us or shown in profile, so we can't really distinguish their faces, but their clothing appears to be Middle Eastern. It's more as if they are a generalized representation of a Middle Eastern figure rather than representations of specific people. What's perhaps most notable about these figures is their gestures of prayer. This is a motif that Jerome repeated in his Orientalist works, but just how accurate his depiction of these gestures is has also been questioned. Scholars have proposed that rather than sketching these practices from real life observation, Jerome was instead very likely working from a book, Edward William Lane's An Account of the Manners and Customs of the Modern Egyptians, which was a popular guide to Islamic worship that included illustrations of the positions and gestures involved in traditional Islamic prayer. So now that we've looked at some of the details and determined which aspects are more documentary and which are more on the imaginative side, what is our takeaway? I think for us today, it can be difficult to get into the mindset of Jerome's late 19th century audience. For us, we can hop online and see pictures and videos from around the world, get access to anything that's been written about those places, and even meet people from those places. For Jerome's audience, it was only a select few who had the means and opportunity to travel to the Middle East. So much of the information that was reaching a general audience was secondhand and reflective of the interests and goals of Orientalist artists and writers. Although this painting appears to have a documentary feel, it's important for us to remember that it was constructed largely from memory in a studio in Paris and not actually on site. Even while he was abroad, Jerome often sketched from memory rather than immediate observation. He once reflected on this practice saying, quote, "Even when worn out after long marches under the bright sun, as soon as our camping spot was reached, I got down to work with concentration. But oh, how many things were left behind of which I carried only the memory away. But one had to continue on with some regret." So what we're seeing here from Jerome is a gathering of details, some of which are rooted in observed reality, but combined in a way that reflects Jerome's memories and personal impressions of what he saw. And as we know, memories aren't always trustworthy and personal impressions are always colored by context. While his goal in traveling was to witness and understand, what actually got translated into paint cannot necessarily be considered eyewitness. Now, did this matter so much to Jerome's audience that the image presented itself as authentic but was more a construction than anything else? Probably not so much. While he did have his detractors, he was highly praised for his ability to capture what people in France thought was the essence of the Orient. For them, it may not have been all that important if the image was accurate or not. Rather, it confirmed their preconceived notions of the Orient and encapsulated a truth about the Orient that had been marinating in French society for decades, but a truth based not so much on immediate observation, but on a romanticized fiction largely informed by colonial politics. And I think that's an important aspect for us to keep in mind when we're looking at these types of Orientalist works. Thank you.
Oh, Katie, thank you. That was so enjoyable. I have a comment / question, something I wish we'd brought up even in the class. What's the year of the painting again?
Around 1880.
Right. So looking at it with you today, I love the way you divide out the dream and the objects of reality, and really emphasizing that we have a kind of dream here. It's also a picture of ritual, and it's a picture of a religious ritual. And one of the things I hadn't really thought about is how Catholic viewers in France might see this, seeing a combination of people in prayer, people in meditation, and also revering a leader's body. And that is such a French thing to do from Napoleon on. So I find myself wondering a little bit, and this is just my own question, about the kind of interest in and tolerance of Muslim faith, for example, in Paris in the 1880s, when according to the kind of inclusive politics of the Third Republic, it was supposedly a time of acceptance of difference, but we know that there was a lot of racialization and prejudice. And suddenly you've got me thinking with this about the way it would play against images of Christian devotion and Christian practice at exactly the same time, because we're only 25 years away from the separation of church and state in France. So I know that wasn't part of your your research, but I guess I'm wondering maybe what your response would be, thinking about this not only as a pseudo-documentarian memoir that's partly made up, but as a picture of religion and ritual.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting point. And yes, I hadn't considered that either.
Yeah, we didn't talk about it last spring, so I'm throwing you a curveball, but I'm really interested in that now. Thank you.
Yeah, I think Jerome was too. I think he was really fascinated with this this practice of praying in front of the tomb of the sultans, which, as I understand, is still something that is done in Turkey as a way to ask for a good favor, health, things like that. So I think Jerome, we get here his understanding and his vision of a kind of timeless Muslim piety and reverence for their rulers. This was the late 19th century, but the rulers that were buried in these tombs were from the 14th to 15th century. So I think there's, this connection he's seeing between these people and their history and their past, and a reverence for the past. So there's definitely an interest on Jerome's part. In terms of from a Christian or a Catholic point of view, I'm not really sure how to go about answering that question, and I'd like to think about it a little bit more. But I think, if you're a religious person, I think there's always interest in what other religions do and how they practice and how they pray. And, I showed some images from that book by William Lane of the gestures made by Muslims while in prayer. And so I think perhaps that's something that may have been of particular interest to a European audience unfamiliar with Islam and with the processes of the rituals. So I think that emphasis there on the gestures is really indicative of the types of things that Jerome's audience would have been interested in seeing and learning about these foreign and exotic religions.
Right. Oh, I think there's more of a conversation to have here. I'm really excited about it. Thank you. With the kind of religiosity and interest in spiritualism in the 80s. You might have some questions in the chat or the Q&A you could turn to.
Yes. Let's see. June has a question about the painting's provenance. So the actual history of this as an object. That's a little tricky. The provenance isn't entirely complete or clear. The museum acquired it in 1915. And actually, before it was acquired, it had several different titles. So the original title, if it even had an original title, we don't know. It was also listed in other sources as the Tombs of the Caliphs, the Faithful at the Sultan's Tomb, and the Sorrows of Akbar. So the dealer that sold it to the museum in 1915, he's the one that actually changed the title to the Sentinel at the Sultan's Tomb. And that's about as far back as the provenance goes, is just right before the museum acquired it. Let's see if there's another. Here's a question from Allison. Do you have any sense of who might have been invited into these spaces where the tombs were kept and who perhaps was not allowed in? Does this painting suggest multiple levels of access, not only access to Oriental peoples and cultures, but also to a private religious political space? That's a really great question. I am not sure who had access to these spaces within Ottoman culture. At the time, Jerome was able to get in there, so foreigners could visit. Now, whether he actually saw people in prayer in these spaces is debated. I'm not sure if this was segregated in terms of gender or anything like that. But I think the fact that Jerome got access to it, I mean, that's privileged for him, certainly, as an outsider, as a foreigner. I don't know if they were guarded, as the title indicates. That's something that really I think I should probably look a little further into, the access to the spaces. It's a really great question.
Well, thank you. I think we're at our time now. So I just want to say a huge thank you. And Katie, you can leave your PowerPoint up. Oh, never mind. You're good. I just want to say a huge thank you to everyone, to Hoyon, Elizabeth, and Katie. I know that clearly you've inspired folks to come to the museum. Several people have, you know, asked where they can find these paintings. And luckily they're in two galleries, so Gallery 205 and Gallery 207. So I hope you come and see them. And of course, thank you so much, Dr. Childs, for encouraging these students to share their work with the museum's audiences. And I do want to let everyone know that this has been recorded, and we are going to work in the coming weeks to get this up on the museum's website in case you wanted to share it with anyone or rewatch it for your own enjoyment. So thank you. And I'd like to encourage everyone to check out slam.org/events, where you will find a combination of virtual and in-person programming coming up in the next few days and weeks, including the return of Slam Underground on Friday. So that is very exciting. We haven't had one of those since February of 2020. So we're happy to have it back. So just thank you to everyone.
Thank you. We are really honored to have the chance to do this. It's so wonderful to be able to reach out and revisit these pictures, and we hope to see you all in the gallery soon.
Perfect. Well, thank you all, and I hope everyone has a great day. Thanks. Bye-bye.